Hi everyone, my name is Dr. Aidan Sharkey. I'm an attending anesthesiologist at the Beth Israel Deaconess Medical Center in Boston, Massachusetts. And today I'm going to be giving the first of a three-part lecture series on point-of-care ultrasound. The key takeaways of this talk will be to give some background on point-of-care ultrasound, then discuss probe selection, and talk about basic knobology on the ultrasound system before going over core probe motions required for imaging. First of all, what is point-of-care ultrasound, or POCUS as we know it? Well, point-of-care ultrasound refers to the use of portable ultrasonography at a patient's bedside for diagnostic, monitoring, or therapeutic purposes. POCUS is really an umbrella term for the use of ultrasound at the patient's bedside for the evaluation of multiple organ systems, such as lung, abdomen, airway, DVT, and cardiac function. It can also be used for directing procedures such as regional anesthesia and vascular access techniques. The use and incorporation of point-of-care ultrasound into clinical care has exploded in recent years, and this is primarily due to technological advances in ultrasound equipment. The evolution of ultrasound systems from large cart-based systems to more portable laptop-based systems to handheld pocket probes that we currently utilize has allowed the rapid expansion of point-of-care ultrasound. What was once deemed a desirable skill amongst physicians is quickly becoming an expectation across a wide range of specialties. We will now move on to probe selection for point-of-care ultrasound. In general, probes used for point-of-care ultrasound are classified as either curvilinear, linear, or phased array probes. The footprint of the probe and the frequency of ultrasound waves emitted are the major differing factors between probes. For cardiac ultrasound, which we are discussing today, we generally choose the phased array probe. This probe is chosen for its small footprint, along with its low frequency, thus giving good tissue penetration. For all ultrasound probes, it is important to make note of the transducer indicator on the ultrasound device and which side of the image this corresponds to on the screen. This becomes very important for correct anatomical display on our echo views. In terms of basic knobology, there are two basic functions we need to be aware of on the ultrasound system in order to optimize our image. The optimal depth setting is when all structures of interest can be viewed on the screen. No more, no less. In this example, we have a parasternal long axis view, and we can see that the descending aorta is the deepest structure of interest and is correctly located at the bottom of the screen. We can see in the image on the left of the screen that the imaging depth is too deep and there is a lot of wasted real estate in the far field, whereas the image on the right is too shallow and we are cutting off structures of interest. Moving on to the second basic function we need to be aware of on the ultrasound system, and that is the gain setting. What gain does is simply determine how bright or how dark you want your image to appear. Increasing the overall gain, as shown in the image on the left, will increase the gain or brightness for all reflected sound waves, making all objects in the image wider. It does this by increasing the strength of returning ultrasound signals that you visualize on the screen. Conversely, reducing the gain as seen on the image on the right will darken the image by reducing the strength of the returning ultrasound signals that you visualize on the screen, making images difficult to visualize. The ideal gain setting, as displayed in this clip, is when the blood endocardial tissue borders are well delineated, as we can see in the video clip here. Moving on to probe manipulations, and there are four cardinal probe motions we need to be aware of in order to help obtain and optimize our images. Sliding the probe involves moving the entire probe in a specific direction, either caudally, cranially, laterally, or medially. This motion is often done to transition between intercostal spaces. Rotating the probe involves turning the transducer in a clockwise or counterclockwise direction along the central axis of the probe. This movement is often done to transition between long and short axes of a specific structure. Tilting or fanning the probe involves moving the transducer from side to side along the short axis of the probe. This motion allows multiple cross-sectional images of a structure to be visualized. Finally, rocking the probe involves moving the probe either towards or away from the probe indicator along the long axis. This motion allows the users to center the area of interest. That concludes our first lecture on basic cardiac point-of-care ultrasound, in which we discussed probe selection, basic knobology, and basic probe manipulations. Thank you for watching, and I hope you found this topic helpful.